Hi. Today we're going to talk about Mozart. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Now, many of you have perhaps seen the film Amadeus. Great, great, great film. And that certainly gives the student of Mozart some hints. That's the best that can be done, maybe. Though the film is not, as you know, primarily about Mozart. I'll also talk about that film, because that needs some analysis. The normal, especially young student, will not really understand that film. Let's talk about the film first. Okay, Amadeus. What a strange title. Wolfgang's middle name. The point there is, perhaps it implies a hidden Mozart, or the lesser-known Mozart, as opposed to Wolfgang, the kind of public persona, or mask. The film is, the central character, of course, is Salieri, Antonio Salieri. And the author, the actor who played him, what was his name? Won the Academy Award as Best Actor. And really, Mozart's role was a little bit supporting. But really, he's on the screen more. He spends more time on the screen than Salieri does, so that's not fair. But Salieri, the story is centrally about Salieri. It's an analysis, really, of sin. It's a very serious but comical and joyful film, the best combination. Okay, as you know, at the beginning of the film, I've seen the film maybe 50 times, maybe more. My wife and I used to show it to our children in their childhood, and they've seen it 50 times or more. There are many parts that we know every word to, and I would urge any of you to see it 50 times or later show your children that film 50 times. What better entertainment, what better musical training, what better intellectual training, if you explain it to them. Okay, at the beginning of the film, Salieri, now quite an old man, in Vienna, virtually the whole film takes place in Vienna. Wien, as you guys call it, properly, because in German it's Wien. In English, Vienna. At the beginning, Salieri, we hear screams, shouts of one man in the distance. We hear a thump, a body apparently falling to the floor. And then some servants are knocking at the door. They fetch some delicious Viennese pastry, whipped cream, very rich, very elegant, and the servant tries to lure Salieri to the door behind the closed door he won't open by means of that whipped cream, rich, thick whipped cream. That's indicative of where the film is going and what the level it's on right away. The next scene we see the servants break through the door apparently. And there is Salieri sitting on the floor, gesturing helplessly, a huge throat wound, self-inflicted, on his throat, bleeding profusely. He had tried to commit suicide. He's rushed to some hospital. And meanwhile, Mozartian music is playing wildly in the background, the perfect music. Of course, all the music in the film is Mozart's and is chosen with love and, I think, intelligence and taste and great, it's just brilliant. Everything brilliant. The costumes are the beloved late 18th, now early 19th century clothing that the Europeans love to make films about. Including a film I'll tell you about later, Immortal Beloved, Beethoven, which tells a little bit about Beethoven the man. what's his name? I forget. Anyway, lots of films like that. The Italians and French love to collaborate on films of that era. Okay. Next thing we know, we are in what is apparently an insane asylum, as we could well call it then. A young priest. Is walking through this house of madness, perfunctorily blessing the poor, twisted souls of the inmates. Perfunctory that is done with minimal care, like some essays that students write or some homework students do, or anyone else does. A job that a person does without caring much. He perfunctorily waves at these very crazy people. On the other hand, the sense in this film is very important, is that although these are twisted souls, and although terrible things, they're in cages and things like that, we're never really disgusted. We're not allowed to become disgusted. Anyway, the priest goes in, comes to a private room. Clearly this is a wealthy man or a high-ranking man. And the patient's back is to us, and he's playing a harpsichord, I think. It's not the full piano. The priest comes in, sits down, and slowly the man turns around. He has a huge... His throat is wrapped. It's Salieri. So Salieri recovered from his attempted suicide and is now probably spending the rest of his days in this home for the insane. He has a sardonic grin on his face. Sardonic is kind of sarcastic. Charming, cynical, witty, as he sees this priest. Of course, he knows why the priest is there. Some high-ranking, maybe the emperor himself, sent the priest to hear Salieri's confession. Clearly, he can speak. And this might be the first time he speaks to anyone about why he tried to kill himself. So the grin on his face speaks tomes. Tomes are volumes. They have sent an infant here to understand some deep problems. I'm going to have to educate this priest. That's what it says, and that's what happens in the film, because the priest is in way over his head. He should know all this as a priest, but even priests don't understand despair, anger at God, and the many ramifications of that. The film says. So that's the first thing the smile says. So this will amuse Salieri to tell his story and educate the priest at the same time. Secondly, what a setting. The priest, the court composer, musician, in this madhouse, and yet there's a kind of fittingness about it that's wonderful, delicious, ironic. Not too cynical, but worldly, certainly. Okay. His first words to the priest. He turns around and says, "Do you know this music? Play something." Briefly. The priest says, "I'm sorry, I don't know it." "How about this? It was very famous in its time." "I'm very sorry, I guess I don't know it." And then he turns around. Dun 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 dun. "Oh yes, I know that. That's wonderful. That's charming. I didn't know you composed that." "I didn't. Mozart did. That was Mozart." And off we go. Because right away, we're plunged into the essence of Salieri's rage and despair. Salieri explains He Salieri was arguably the greatest, the most famous, the most successful composer in Europe in his time. He was the emperor's court composer. He wrote 40 operas alone, all successful. Mozart comes along and effortlessly, a genius, which Salieri admittedly is not, and that's the problem. Effortlessly, it seems, this little man, this boy almost, composes these pieces that everyone loves, admires, no one forgets. That's the problem. So Salieri tells his story. As a boy in a northern Italian town, his father, a businessman, not very wealthy, but okay. Salieri very early had loved music. His father couldn't care less about music. By the way, that's an expression that is being corrupted in our time. Because American kids will say, "I could care less." What they mean is, "I couldn't care less." "I could care less" has the opposite meaning. That means there is some way that I could care less. But the point of the expression is, there is no way that I could care less. In other words, I am indifferent to whatever it is we're talking about. Anyway, father couldn't care less. And we see Salieri in church in his town, the boys' chorus singing beautiful music, and Salieri as a boy, 12, 13, speaking, praying, speaking to God, praying that God give him the power to create beautiful music, and he will glorify God, he promises, and he will give his soul to God. He will give his chastity to God, that is, he will not seek after pleasures of the flesh. He will gladly surrender everything. Maybe the next day, very soon thereafter, he and his family are eating outside in a charming Italian way at the table. Suddenly, his father chokes on maybe a fishbone, chokes, is dead. Dies right there. It's a funny scene. Shouldn't be, but it is. The boy's glances are not horror, but wonder at apparently at God's ways. Because, oh my God, God has answered my prayers. First of all, he'll begin by killing my father, making it possible for me to have a full music education. God is working his will. This is how God works. Well, these are already very dangerous words, and if you've seen any other of our films, you'll know my view on that. There is nothing more absurd in a world full of absurdities. In religion, which is so full of absurdities, there is nothing more absurd than the claim to see God's work, God's will at work. That is even more absurd than the other things. Of course, we can't see God's will at work. We can see what we hope is, but it's all our wishful thinking, and it's all, frankly, very superstitious. It's so silly. And it belittles God so much and exalts us so much. Yes, God, we're on the same team. We're teammates. We're buddies. God and I are buddies. Yeah, I see what you're up to, God, and I approve. What nonsense. Okay, but that's where Salieri is, and that's frankly, I think, where most people are. And I'm afraid that's even where many theologians are. I'm digressing, I'm aware of that. But Christianity, the Judeo-Christian system, claims to understand history. That's just as absurd. Just as absurd. And it sees a direction in history, and it sees just what God is up to. How absurd. We should be ashamed. We belittle God so. Anyway, that's why I love Job, because although God speaks, of course it's all a metaphor, it's all just a poet. In fact, much religion is simply poets at work or theologians at work. and the rest of us servilely going along, creating dogmas and creeds from what is only poetry after all. Okay, sorry. Salieri. So then he gets a musical training. He's sent, of course, to Vienna, and quickly he rises to be court composer, the highest position in Europe, the emperor's court composer in the greatest court in Europe at the time. A great emperor too. What was his name? Joseph the Second or Franz Joseph? I don't remember anymore. But the emperor is a major player in this film too. Wonderful. The cast is wonderful. Okay. So Salieri has made it. He's successful and he's composing, doing exactly what he loves, to an audience that loves him apparently. Really loves the emperor, and the emperor loves him. Does the emperor love his work? Maybe. But in this film, and even in Salieri's opinion, if the emperor loves his work, it must be junk, trash. If the emperor loves it, it must be trash. And Salieri knows it. Okay, now Salieri, still a young man, has heard of the boy composer Mozart. Everyone had. And Mozart was expected in Vienna any day. Salieri was excited. He will attend this concert. At this point, Mozart is about 18 to 20, still a very young man. Salieri, 25 to 30. So the day arrives. Salieri goes to this concert hall. It's not like a theater. It's more like a private home that has been cleared. Beautiful high ceilings, Rococo 18th century design on the walls, everything wonderful. There's a small orchestra, and they're waiting for the boy composer, the Wunderkind, as the Germans called him, other people too, is simply a child prodigy in English. Prodigy meaning a wonder, a child prodigy being a boy or girl who can perform far beyond the abilities of the normal boy or girl at that stage. A precocious child is another way to put this. Okay, Salieri, it's another hint of what's going on here, sneaks into the refreshment room, and there it's like paradise to a person who loves food like that. Paradise. It's like being in a Viennese, one of the most elegant Viennese Stockhaus, as it used to be the most elegant, famous, world famous Stockhaus Konditorei, or sweets and pastry place. And there's just table after table of this beautiful food. And this excites Salieri. Now, this should remind us of the opening scene where the servants try to lure him to open the door by saying, "Oh, this pastry is so delicious. Herr Salieri, wait till you taste this." There's a hint of what's going on. That is, I'll get to the heart of it quickly. Salieri, we see Salieri as guilty of all the seven deadly sins. Wow, the seven deadly sins again. I've taught this before on Dr. Shin's in Dr. Shin's productions here, but quickly I'll teach you a way to remember them. Take the word agape. Everyone knows that. Koreans know it. Unconditional love, God's love for us and the world. What we should but are utterly incapable of, should be able to achieve but are utterly incapable of even coming close to. Okay. Add an SL in the front of agape and we get slagape, which is kind of an ugly word. A Korean student of mine yesterday, when he saw the word sluggish, knew immediately that this is not a nice thing. It's an ugly word. Put SL in front of agape, and slagape is an ugly word. Suddenly, agape has become ugly. S, sloth. I won't explain the meanings. L, lust. A, avarice. G, gluttony. Other A, anger. That's where I have to cheat, because the word is wrath. But anger will do. P, pride. E, envy. There's a nice little mnemonic device that is helpful to the memory, which will help you remember the seven deadly sins. And that is important. And sometime, if Dr. Shin and I are desperate for a theme, I want to tell you about another great, great film called Seven, based exactly on the seven deadly sins. Okay, back to Mozart. There's Salieri tasting these delicious things, and suddenly he hears a noise of people coming in to this room. He quickly hides under the table, embarrassed, and in come a young man and young woman, who we quickly realize are Mozart, and some girl, dressed in very low-cut décolletage, low-cut neckline, giggling, and they start playing on the floor. He wants to persuade her to play around sexually. She resists, but only gigglingly. And Salieri watches, horrified, amazed. He gets his first glimpse of this man who was his idol, I-D-O-L, Mozart. And what is this first glimpse? This dirty little boy, as he calls him over and over again, the creature, as he constantly calls Mozart, the creature is really a very unimpressive, normal, somewhat distasteful, unlikable, perhaps, creature. And quickly, Salieri is realizing, excuse me? God chose this creature instead of me? God gave these gifts, the gift of genius, the gift of music, to this nasty little creature and not to me? This is intolerable. Well, we see where the film is going. They play around, and then pretty soon we hear the music in the background, and Mozart immediately stops his playing. They've started without me. They're playing my music. Very quickly he stands up and he's out of there, because he does care about music. He cares deeply about music. Music is, well, he's a musical genius. Quickly he gets up, leaves the room, arrives, tries to compose himself, assumes the baton from his first violinist, probably, and starts to continues to conduct his own work, tries to save the day. Well, it turns out what happened was the Archbishop of Salzburg, his boss, Mozart's boss, had arrived. No one knew where Mozart was. The Archbishop is always annoyed at Mozart, because Mozart was Mozart, doing things just like this, probably always late, undependable, unserious, frivolous, a great composer already, but frivolous. So the Archbishop had said, begin without him. So the Archbishop is furious at Mozart, because according to the Archbishop in the interview afterwards, Mozart had publicly embarrassed him. Well, the Archbishop isn't totally wrong, of course, but the Archbishop is a pompous man, a pompous ass. It's impossible to use any other words about such a man. And there are lots of pompous asses around. I'm sure the schools are full of them. The world is full of them. I hope I'm not. I don't think I am. Maybe I should be more pompous. Okay, anyway, next we get the interview between Mozart and the Archbishop. The Archbishop says, "Why, Mozart? Why? Why what?" By the way, Mozart has approached the big room in which the Archbishop is waiting for him through an adoring crowd. Everyone is saying, "Oh, Mozart, you're so wonderful, so wonderful." And he knows it. Mozart knows it. So when Mozart enters the room, he's full of self-confidence. "Why what, Your Excellency? Why must I be embarrassed by one of my servants?" Well, this is going to burn Mozart, and maybe any artist and composer, because the position of the artist and composer had risen gradually from the Renaissance, quickly, in a man like Titian, or Raphael, or Michelangelo, or Leonardo, the Renaissance geniuses. Before these guys, artists were kind of servants. They were craftsmen. They were anybody, nobody. Now, suddenly, they are geniuses. The word genius was first used in this way in the Renaissance. It's a typical Renaissance word. And so Mozart does not regard himself as a servant, and frankly most people would not have regarded him as one either, nor Salieri. But the pompous archbishop says, "By one of my servants." Mozart says, "If Your Excellency doesn't approve of me or doesn't like me, Your Excellency can simply release me." Because Mozart was basically under contract, but contracts were serious business, and the archbishop could hold him against his will for the rest of his life. He could throw him in prison, of course. So Mozart wants to be free and wants to settle down in Vienna. The archbishop refuses, and Mozart somewhat rudely leaves. And when he opens the doors that are 50 feet high, opens the doors, there's the crowd waiting for Mozart to emerge, 50, 60 people, all of them just adoring him. Mozart then bows to the crowd, but in bowing to the crowd, he has turned his back to the archbishop, and basically he is showing his buttocks to the archbishop. Whoa! Archbishop gives an angry signal. The servants slam the door on Mozart. We know that relationship is over. Now, background. Mozart's father was court composer to the archbishop in Salzburg. Now, Salzburg was just a town. Salzburg was not, is still like Gumi, I imagine. Gumi is to Daegu as Salzburg was and is to Vienna. That's a little bit true. Though Vienna is much larger than Daegu. 8 million, 7 or 8 million, I imagine. Okay, so Mozart is free of the archbishop, settles down in Vienna, starts writing and is very popular, has a girlfriend, in fact it's the same girl, Constanze is her name, whom he perhaps will, whom he will marry. Okay, then comes the operatic phase. Mozart starts to compose operas. And the first opera that's important, I know I'm taking a long time with this, but this is Mozart, and I'll still have plenty of time to discuss his works. And I will be discussing his works along with the film, so I think we're okay. Die Entführung aus dem Serail. The abduction from the Seraglio. Now, Salieri learns that Mozart is writing an opera about a harem. A harem was, in the Muslim world, for the caliphs and high-ranking people in the Muslim Empire, basically. They could have more than one wife, so can a Korean. And many concubines and mistresses, and they were all kept in the harem, guarded strictly so that no one else could touch these beautiful women, often by eunuchs, castrati. Eunuch is slightly different, who were sexually incapable of performing. No danger there. Okay, so Salieri learns that Mozart is writing an opera about such a subject. He tells the emperor, and the emperor is a little bit horrified, because is this a good subject for a Christian Western audience, morality and all this stuff summons Mozart in. Ah, wait, skipping something. Earlier, before this, oh, great, great scene. Oh, wonderful. Maybe the best. Earlier, the emperor had stated a wish to, he wanted to meet Mozart, this young Austrian composer, after all. Bring him to me. Now, before, on the day when Mozart is scheduled to meet the emperor, the emperor wakes up, is dressed. Well, gentlemen, what do you have for me today? And one of the five or six close advisors to the emperor says, Sire, Mozart is here. You're to meet Mozart. Oh, wow, this is a big moment for the emperor. Okay, so the emperor is not a pompous ass. He's a very good man. Anyway, oh my God, send him in. Then there's Salieri saying, Sire, I wrote a little composition in his honor, in Mozart's honor. Wonderful interaction. The emperor says, has a look at it, sees that it's relatively easy. May I play it? You do me honor, you do it honor, sire. So then the emperor sits down and plays about like I did, I imagine, ages ago after my 1.5 year lessons, never practicing. Bad at, he's bad. He's bad. Many of you, most of you watching this, play much better than the emperor did, I bet, after your years of piano lessons. But anyway, Salieri, done. Well, let's, you know, it doesn't matter, but Salieri tries to train the emperor, and the emperor says, send for Mozart, but slowly, slowly. Wonderful man. He needs some time to practice. And it's a charming piece. And so Mozart enters. Oh, Mozart has dressed up for this with a special wig, the special powders, special outfit. And by the way, the symbol of Mozart, the most pervasive symbol of Mozart in the film, is his laughter. It's this this high-pitched, obnoxious cackle. I'm told I laugh like that sometimes. Maybe many people do. But it's this high-pitched, obnoxious laugh. Which symbolizes Mozart in the film as a kind of silly, unlikable man. Okay, so Mozart enters. He listens politely, but really his mind is on other things. He's bowing flatteringly, self-ingratiatingly to these various people whom he recognizes, who are famous men. Everyone in the room is a famous man, and Mozart wants to make a good impression. Finally, the emperor stops playing this little piece, and he says, "Ah, Mozart, I have met you before. When I was a little boy, you came as a little boy and performed for me and my sister Marie Antoinette. You who know some history know that she was the Queen of France, the wife of Louis XVI, Louis the XVI." Tells a little story there. Mozart gives another of his that obnoxious laugh. And everyone looks around. Embarrassing. This man has no class. This man has no elegance, no savoir-faire, no sense of how to conduct himself in such a situation. And that's how Mozart is presented, as a coarse, well, that's Salieri's perception anyway, and it probably was true. A somewhat dirty-minded, coarse, not very refined person who happens to be a musical genius, the musical genius. And I think that's true. Okay, so now Mozart, are you going to compose an opera for us? Yes, sire. Let it be in German. In German? That's unthinkable. German was regarded as a barbaric language. I'm going to tell a little story on the aside, a famous story that you should know, and I tell it to my students. The Emperor Charles V, whom I mentioned in the Italian Renaissance lecture, great man, and a linguist too, because his mother was Spanish, his father was a Habsburg, German. He grew up receiving a French education in Belgium, mostly, and he spent many years in Italy, and loved Italy. So one day a flattering courtier said, "Oh, sire, when do you like to use these languages?" And his answer was, apparently, that he liked to use French with men. The reason for that, most Koreans do not understand, I think, is that French is the language of wit. French is the language of wit. He liked to use Italian with women. Italian is a vigorous language, charming, the language of charm. Wit too, but charm more. Spanish with God, probably because his mother was Spanish and the ties were deep emotionally. For him, it was the language of religious passion. And German with his horse. That explains the emperor's reaction and everyone's reaction. What, an opera in German? That's like a horse opera. German is too gross, too crude, as one of the courtiers says in the room. Ah, signore, German is so German. He's a German, of course. German is so brutal, brutal. Let it be German, says Mozart, because I have found the most wonderful libretto or text. Immediately, the courtier who has charge of all the theaters, who is a pompous ass, another pompous ass, says, "Oh, really? Have I seen it?" And Mozart says, "Well, it's very new, but I, of course, will show it to you right away, Herr, whatever he is." "Yes, I think you better," says the pompous ass, who hates Mozart from the start. "What's it about?" says the emperor, who's a good-natured, kindly man. "It's about..." "It's about..." Everyone's saying, "What? What's it about?" "It's about a seraglio." "What?" says the ignorant man, with a German accent. "A harem, a brothel." Brothel, of course, it's not. A brothel is a house of prostitution. A seraglio, or a harem, of course, is not a house of prostitution. It's just a place where many women are kept for the pleasure of one man, an emperor. So that shows what we are introduced to in this scene is the politics of Vienna, into which Mozart will be plunged, and immediately he will be over his head. He's not a politician. Salieri is. Salieri knows the game. Instinctively, he plays the game very well, or he would not have become the court composer, especially at such an early age. He's a gamester. Mozart doesn't play well. He's too self-absorbed. He's not observant enough, and he's also too proud. But anyway, half of the people in the room say, "Yes, let it be German." The other half say, No. It's got to be Italian. French, okay, but Italian is the language of opera." The emperor says, "I would like a German opera for German people, full of good German virtues." Who says, anyway? Mozart, "Is this full of German virtues?" Yes, I think it is, although it's about a harem." And Salieri says, "I'm sorry, I'm a stranger. I'm a foreigner. What are these German virtues?" And Mozart says, "Love." And Salieri says sarcastically, "Oh, we Italians know nothing about love." Sarcastically, and everyone laughs, because the Italians are lovers. Every Italian, one supposes, is a lover, just like every Korean is a mathematician, you know. But what Salieri has in mind is a kind of love as a game. Love is playing around. And Mozart responds, "No, I think you do. know nothing about love. Because he has in mind a romantic, deeper Romeo and Juliet. In his view, the Italians don't do this well. A bunch of screeching sopranos, and then he makes an obscene joke. He says, anyway, everyone is horrified because he has said a bad word, the S-dot-dot-dot-T word, in front of the emperor. But the emperor is not a pompous ass, and he's not going to be offended by that. But he is a little worried about Mozart's judgment of things, and he has reason to be. Because after all, our time here, Mozart arrives there in Vienna around 1780. Well, 1789 is the year of the French Revolution, and everyone knows that something bad might very well happen in France soon, 9 years. And the emperor's sister, after all, is the Queen of France. He's worried, and everyone in Europe was worried, and they didn't want to put on anything on the stage that might upset the common people. But the emperor is a very good man, too. So, okay, do your opera. The opera is a huge success. I could talk for 2 hours about this film. I better not. And yet it's so great. It's so important. I hope Dr. Shin will let me. Is it okay? It's so great. Anyway, after the opera... Oh, Salieri has a pupil, a beautiful soprano who stars in the opera. She's a very beautiful young woman, voluptuous, that is very sexy, and Salieri, it's clear, is very attracted to her, but his vow of chastity to God. This shows, as I said before, that Salieri is really guilty of the seven deadly sins, but he covers it all up, claiming to have given himself to God. But he has, of course, not given himself to God. All of this is simply his own vanity. God, make me a great composer, and I'll do anything for you. But even if God had made him a Mozart, had given him a genius like that, he, and no man, would have been very capable of giving everything to God, because so full of himself and his own personal glory, so consumed by his ambition to be really great and a genius, that this gift to God stuff is all, of course, nonsense. And we know that already. And we didn't need Salieri to tell us that either. Okay, so after the opera, the emperor climbs up on stage to congratulate Mozart. And Mozart is standing there with Constanza. We will call her Stanzi from now on, her nickname throughout the film. And who is this young lady? And Stanzi's mother is there, Frau Weber. Your Majesty, they are going to get married. She is Mozart's fiancée. And suddenly the soprano who's there, this beautiful woman who has flowers in her arm given to her by the emperor, is furious. And Mozart, it's clear that Mozart had been having an affair with the soprano. Mozart says, well, I'm not exactly engaged to her, not altogether. That obnoxious laugh. The soprano throws the flowers at Mozart, and Salieri says, and then I realized that he had had my darling. He had had that woman whom I loved. Well, loved, maybe not, but you see where Salieri is. He hates Mozart now. Hates him even worse than before. And the next scene, Salieri in his room, near the fireplace, he takes down the crucifix. I have one here. The cross, Christ on the cross. And he says, why? 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 Why have you given this musical genius to that dirty little monster, that obscene little creature, and denied it to me? He throws the cross into the fire. He has declared war on God. Well, if there's a definition of madness, that would be pretty much it. That's what an absurd, an insane thing to do. But really, it's no more absurd than much of religion in practice, I would say. Our adoration is very often on that very same superstitious, silly level. It's like going to war with the universe, though God is much, much greater than the universe. If there is a God, let's face it, the God who created the universe is much greater than the universe. The words great, these words have no meaning at all. These are silly words that we use to try to make some sense of things. Anyway, so he's going to try to spoil God's plan. More silliness. He's going to try to destroy God's creature, the little creature, Mozart. Everything Mozart tries to do, he, Salieri, will try to mess him up, defeat him, circumvent all his efforts to be successful and great. And this becomes the main subject of the film. We're maybe one third through the film right now. Salieri now goes to work. Well, this is a man then who has declared war on God. This is a man who is damned already, really. If there's a serious criticism of the film, it's that the film is not about such a man, or treats its theme in a much too shallow, silly, amusing way. Silly, maybe not, but amusing. That is, such a theme is a very weighty, serious theme, but it's not treated seriously in the film. But still, the film it manages to be a serious film, although it evades the full implications of that great theme, which is also, by the way, the theme of Faust, Goethe's Faust, Marlowe's Faust, in a sense, by making this compact with Satan, Mephistopheles Satan, Faust has declared war on God too, and that's exactly what happens in Marlowe's. Marlowe's play, Christopher Marlowe's Elizabethan play in Shakespeare's time, 1590, is relatively serious in its treatment of that theme. Goethe's long and great, in its way, epic poem called Faust does not treat the central theme seriously. Treats it in a kind of Protestant sentimentalized humanist way. Goethe too, a heavily under the influence of the limitations and myths of his time. Okay, back to our film. So Mozart starts composing, and we watch him run around Vienna. He's often drinking, but he composes with his facility of composition, the ease with which he composes, his work ethic, which although he drank and played around, was huge. Every day, hours and hours composing. The difference between him and others was, though, that he could compose so easily, and second, okay, I better save that. Salieri is at work. For example, the emperor has a niece, and they are out riding in the woods. This is the emperor. Runs into Salieri, and the emperor says, "Composer Salieri, this is my niece. I need a piano teacher for her." And Salieri says, "You do me too much honor, sir," because Salieri, of course, assumes that the emperor means Salieri. I was thinking about Mozart. So many scenes like that. From the point of view of the film, this is God mocking Salieri, because Salieri has these moments he hopes are of his own greatness, and every time, boom! And every time it's Mozart that does this to him, crushes him like an insect. So, Salieri, the courtier, though, the sharp politician, and he says, "Oh, Do you think that's a good idea, sire? Because some people will think you're guilty of favoritism. The emperor says, you know, you're right. I'll have a contest with judges. But it's clear that Mozart should be the winner. Well, Salieri goes to work to make sure that Mozart does not win the contest. Mozart comes to protest against this injustice to one of the other courtiers who actually likes Mozart. He says, why do I have to submit my work to teach some little girl piano? Generally, Mozart avoids having students because composition is what he loves. But having students is the way, I know about this, is the way to make money. Perfect. But composition is what he wants to be doing. Me too. But that's okay. I'm okay with that. I'll tell you about that in the autobiography time. What a parallel. Wow. I'm no Mozart. More. Anon. Okay, my God. So Mozart is offended that he even has to submit his work to some judges. And who are these works? Judges? Of course, the Italiani. Of course, the Italians. He hates them because he considers himself far superior to them. And of course, he was. But the nice man says, why do you have to? Because the emperor says you have to. And if I don't submit my stuff, then you will not win the job. Of course, the job is very lucrative. A lot of money for Mozart. Mozart says, I won't do it. Okay, then you won't have the job, says this charming, basically admirer of Mozart. But after all, the rules are the rules. And we're getting a glimpse of Mozart's spirit, that is, he's aware of who he is. He's aware of his genius. And he really thinks, and maybe he's right, that other people aware of it should basically pay him money so that he can compose and flood the world with great, great music, which is kind of what he did. It wasn't all great, of course. The time of greatness arrives kind of slowly, and we'll discuss that later when we discuss the music itself. But we're getting a glimpse of this in the film, too. Okay, next, Mozart's father. We haven't seen much of him, but he's a very imposing man, Leopold Mozart. As I said, composer for the archbishop. And, of course, he had been the teacher of little Mozart. And little Mozart was a genius. At 3, at 5, at 7, at 9. Had traveled around Europe being like a trained monkey, someone had said, performing in the courts and for the wealthy. This Wunderkind, this child prodigy. Okay, so suddenly Leopold, the father, arrives. Mozart is married by now. He went ahead and got married without the blessing of his father. His father had tried to stop the wedding, but Mozart had gone through with it. Great music in the background. Suddenly, Dad arrives. And Dad is dressed in black, black hat, black cape, scary guy. And we hear a knock on the outside door. Mozart's apartment is up on the first floor, kind of a nice apartment. And Mozart goes to the door, and he looks down at the bottom of the stairs, and suddenly in comes this scary guy dressed in black, and his dad. He removes his hat, Papa! With joy at seeing his father, goes to greet him, but Dad is not amused. Dad is not happy. Dad has come there to really scold his wayward son because he disapproves of the marriage, he disapproves of the living in Vienna, he disapproves of Mozart's devoting all his time to composition. He disapproves of Mozart's way of life, important, because Mozart was always in debt. Mozart lived beyond his means. Mozart drank and partied and spent money lavishly and never kept close account of his money. And his wife tried to keep order, but she couldn't do it. She was younger and she was kind of frivolous too when she was young. Later, no. And so Leopold has come to scold his son. But son apologizes for everything, but tries to defend what he's doing. When son presents his Stanzi, well, it must be, let's say it's 12 or 1 in the afternoon. Stanzi is still in bed, asleep. Mozart's been up for hours composing, of course. Not well dressed or anything like that. So Mozart slips into the bedroom. My love, maybe it's time to get up. My father's here. Oh my God! So she comes out, charming, but still asleep at 1, and the house is kind of a mess. Plates, nothing clean, nothing very nice. Mozart blames himself. You know what a pig I am, he says. She takes very good care of me. She feeds me. You look thin to me. No, she's wonderful. And she's pregnant. We're expecting a child. Leopold is not amused, is not pleased. There's a blinking red light here. Does it mean anything? Leopold, father, is not amused. He has come to stay for a while, some months in fact, but a lot of tension in that house. When the in-laws stay, especially for a long time, I don't know, maybe even in Korean homes, a little tension. Anyway, Mozart goes on with composition, composes all the time, and the great works are starting. The 80s, after all, Mozart died in 1790. The 80s, that decade, were, especially the last half of it, were like those last 5 years of Vincent's life, very similar. Vincent died at 37, by the way, as I told you, Mozart at 35. Both of them died in 90, 1790, 1890. Superstitious people will try to find parallels and push them too far, I think. Maybe I've been guilty of that, I don't think so. But kind of interesting anyway. But the one was a suicide and the other was maybe murdered. That's one of the points of the film. Okay, so tension rises and then pretty soon we have open quarrels. And Leopold says, this place is disgusting. You guys are disgusting. I'm leaving. Papa, don't leave, don't leave. What we see, the most important thing happening here, is Mozart's deep desire to please his father. But his desire, of course, to be great is more important, and he knows that if he becomes really great, he will, I suppose, please his father. But father is a little bit dictatorial, domineering, imperious. So Mozart is caught in a kind of guilt thing that probably many sons are caught in. Can I live up to my father's expectations? I want to please my father. I want my father to be proud of me. But I'm doing that in the way, the best way I can, and I think I have to follow my own lights, my own vocation, calling, in this sense. Okay, and we start to get the Don Giovanni music. The Don Giovanni music will be heavily about Mozart and his father. Other things happening. Salieri has not been idle. He has hired a maid, and the maid comes to the door while Leopold is still there. That's typical. Mozart goes to the door, and here's this strange young woman. I have been sent to you by an admirer to be your maid, your housemaid, free of charge. Stanzi and Leopold both come to the door, too. It's a charming scene, actually. And Leopold's attitude, as stern, puritanical that he is, you can't possibly let a stranger into our house. Stanzi, our house? Of course, people love Mozart and they're always sending him presents. And this is just another present. Tension between the daughter-in-law and father-in-law. Ooh, Mozart in the middle. pretty soon the maid is there. But the maid is a spy for Salieri. Salieri pays her to come to him and report on what goes on in that house. And she reports that he drinks heavily, but he works all the time. Salieri, of course, is almost bitter, almost is not and not happy to learn that. But even Salieri loves Mozart's music, and it moves him to tears. And maybe that's the justification by of the film. For what I'm saying is that his love of Mozart's music, his tears, his ecstasy. He knows, he knows and loves Mozart's music better than anyone. And that's almost, let's say it's almost his salvation. So while he is nominally, ostensibly, apparently at war with God, the war can't be taken totally seriously because of the love of the music. Now that love is corrupt because it's corrupted by his envy. His profound envy. But now that I think about it, I've never thought of this before. I've never talked about the film at such great length. Now that I think about it, the fact that his Salieri's